packing up the dreams God planted in the fertile soil of you. Can't believe the hopes he's planted means a chapter in your life is through. But we'll keep you close as always. It won't even seem you've gone, 'cause our hearts, in big and small ways, will keep the love that keeps us strong. And friends of friends forever, if the Lord's the Lord of them, and a friend will not say never, 'cause the welcome will not end. Though it's hard to let you go, in the Father's hands we know that a lifetime's not too long to live as friends. No, a lifetime's not too long. And friends are friends forever, if the Lord's the Lord of them, and a friend will not say never, 'cause the welcome will not end. Though it's hard to let you go, in the Father's hands we know that a lifetime's not too long to live as friends. That a lifetime's not too long to live as friends.
Amen. Thank you so much, Ralph. What a friend we had in Kathleen. What a wonderful life, a long life, a gracious life. She loved and she lived and she loved her Lord. So what a privilege to celebrate her life today. This is a service that we are grateful to be able to be a part of and just reflect on how she loved and lived for the Lord Jesus Christ. I have some scripture here I want to begin with today out of the book of Psalms, Psalm 27. The Lord was her hope, the Lord was her help, and so we too turn to the Lord. Psalm 27 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I dread? When evildoers come against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies, my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though an host encamp against me, my heart will not fear. The war arise against me, in spite of this, I shall be confident." Verse 4, one thing I ask from the Lord, that I shall seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his tabernacle and set me high upon a rock. The word of God for the people of God. And it closes, "I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord." Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this psalm that just reminds us that you are our rock, a refuge. Lord, you are faithful, you are true. What you begin, you are faithful to complete, you are faithful to finish. Lord, we thank you so much for the day, years ago, 98 years ago, that Kathleen was born into this world. Lord, we thank you for the day you fearfully and wonderfully made her. You put your hand upon her. You granted her favor. We thank you for the day that she had a spiritual birthday and how that impacted her life and changed her life. So, Lord, I pray you would grace her family today and her friends today. And help us, we welcome your leadership here today to minister to the different needs that are assembled here. Lord, you're able to meet every need according to your glorious riches in Christ Jesus. So for those that are here today that perhaps do not have the hope that Kathleen had, they do not have the hope of heaven, may the Spirit of God quicken them and open their eyes to the reality and the truth that Kathleen knew, that Jesus Christ is Lord. And every tongue will confess that one day. And Lord, for those that are believers, encourage their heart, renew their minds, and just grace them today as they celebrate and remember this wonderful life of Kathleen Haynes. For it's in Jesus' name we have gathered, and it's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. We're so happy to have the choir to be a part of our service today, singing four specials. And Kathleen loved upbeat music. She wanted to celebrate and sing with great joy. And so no better one to start with than Shouting Time, then Stepping on the Clouds, then following my remarks, there'll be two more. So let's worship our great God, just as Kathleen did. Thanks be to God for the joy of Jesus, the joy of eternal life, the joy of knowing that your sins have been covered and you are forgiven. What a wonderful promise in Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. When you understand the depth of what that means, it'll put a song in your heart and it'll put joy in your spirit. And that's exactly what Kathleen had. As I prayed and thought about the oldest member of our Mount Sinai church family and which direction to go, it wasn't long, didn't take me long at all, to wind up in Psalm 100. Psalm 100. It's a psalm of praise. It's a psalm of thanksgiving. It's a psalm that is a fitting climax to the collection of psalms called the Royal Psalms. This psalm describes the process of participation and preparation and anticipation of the people of God going to the house of God in worship. It pictures and presents a band of believers on a journey to the house of God. And when they get to the gates of God, they just all of a sudden burst into praise because of God's goodness and because of God's faithfulness. It just overwhelms them as they have been on this journey. And that's what the context of this psalm. And as I read this psalm, you'll quickly see how it describes and fits so beautifully the life of Kathleen Haynes. I mean, it just pulsates with the evidence and the fruit of her life. Psalm 100 says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful singing. Know that the Lord himself is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His loving kindness is everlasting. And his faithfulness is to all generations." Psalm 100. First of all, I see Kathleen in Psalm 100 because of the smile she kept on her face. The smile she kept on her face. Verse 2a says, "Serve the Lord with gladness." A true test of gratitude and true thanksgiving is serving the Lord with a smile. Being joyful in your service to King Jesus. Not serving begrudgingly. Not serving because you're supposed to or you have to, but because you get to and because you want to. That was Kathleen. Her gratitude toward God and her appreciation for the goodness of God and the mercy of God, the pardon of God, the provision of God compelled her, moved her to serve the Lord with gladness. And it put a big smile on her face when she did. She lit up when she served and shared Jesus with other people. It was just contagious. Her smile was genuine. It was authentic. Her smile reflected the depth of her joy and gratitude from knowing that she was a child of God. She was in the family of God. She had been redeemed by her master and that she was a sheep of his pasture. When I spoke to some of her Sunday school class members, they all talked about how much they enjoyed having her in her class. And I think they're sitting together. Yeah, right back here is her Sunday school class sitting together. She encouraged them with her smile and her comments, her testimonies. Margie Ledbetter said, "She would tell things as they were and even tell things on herself as they were. And this made you laugh, and she would laugh right along with you." For example, several members mentioned to me the red dress story and how she had this red dress all picked out, and that's all I'm going to say about that. Barbara Ellis loved seeing her bebopping down the hallways here at church. You know, she had this special cane and had four prongs on it. But she would pick that cane up, and its cane never touched the ground, but she'd be flying down the halls carrying her cane and wearing that big smile on her face. And what a joy it was to see her coming. Diana Rollins told me she remembers how she always dressed so pretty and love to come eat with the senior saints at her house. We'd often say, when are we going to get to come back to your house and have another time of fellowship together? Diane said Kathleen was so devout in her Christian life. Barbara Bridges told me how the younger members in the class, this is our oldest ladies' Sunday school class, so there's ladies that are a little older and some that are a little younger in there, but how the older, younger ladies looked up to the older ladies and looked to them for wisdom and guidance, as the Bible says we ought to be able to do, but that's not always the case, but it was in this regard. She said, Kathleen taught us by her example. She said they learned so much from Kathleen's life experiences and how she never wavered in her faith and devotion to the Lord. Barbara went on to say that she surely did miss her and her smile when she was no longer able to come to class, but her godly example remained as even though she wasn't there. Speaking of her example of serving the Lord with gladness, another way she did that was giving balloons to the children. The children affectionately called her the balloon lady. And there would be a line around Kathleen after the church service of the kids lining up to get their balloons. She always wanted to make sure every child had a balloon. I see one of them up in the balcony. Arlie would get a balloon. Macy would get a balloon. All the children would get a balloon. She wanted to put a smile on their face. She was happy they were in the house of the Lord. She was serving the Lord with gladness, and she wanted the children to know that there's gladness in the house of the Lord. Did you see the scripture out there from the book of Psalms? I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. She knew the house of the Lord was the place of blessing. You say, well, I just don't have any blessings in my life. Are you in the place of blessing? Kathleen put herself in the place of blessing, in the house of God, so she could experience God and His goodness and His faithfulness. Kathleen also served the Lord with gladness by quilting with the ladies of the church for the church bazaar every year. Some of the biggest items that would be auctioned off would be the quilts. And she loved participating in that. She was a major part of that. As well as doing quilts, not just for the bazaar, but also to be given to others. And by being her pastor, guess what? I was the recipient of 2 quilts. And so what a blessing that was. And guess what? That put a smile on my face. As well as my daughter's favorite baby blanket, baby quilt, had needed some attention, needed some repair. So we took it to Kathleen, and she fixed it up for Carrie and put a smile on Carrie's face. Stephanie told me Mom loved to serve others by making quilts. She said she was always working on one, and I would keep a row of needles threaded for her. Cindy called Kathleen's quilts of love. How you felt so special if you were the recipient of one of these handmade quilts because of the time and the effort and the love poured into every stitch. Wanda contacted me last night, Kathleen's niece, and she said, Aunt Kay made a quilt for all my family events, whether it was a graduation, a marriage, the birth of a child, or something as simple as a birthday. I've always taken meticulous care of those quilts because, after all, they were hand-stitched from Aunt Kay. In the fall and winter months, when I've pulled them out to stay warm, I would think of her and a smile would come to my lips. I always felt like I had a piece of her close to me, and I and my children will cherish them even more in the future. Cindy also said she was my world. She adopted me when I was 5 years old, and growing up, I was the little spoiled one. She said our home didn't have air conditioning, but one room did. We had a window unit, and it was my room, she told me. And on Saturdays, everybody came over to our house, and Aunt Teresa would cut hair, and Mom would make homemade ice cream from fresh cow's milk, which she got down the street. And they had a big time on Saturdays. Some things never change. Guess what Teresa was doing late into the night last night after church? Cutting hair. About 7 heads, I think, she cut last night. But I love what Jim Putnam told me. Jim said about Kathleen, he said, "Kathleen brought us one of the best members Mount Sinai has ever had, her daughter Teresa." Well said, Jim. What a blessing. Randy told me how his mother was a prayerful mother. And he knew when he was on the road driving his truck that she was faithfully interceding for him, praying for him every morning at 6 o'clock, every evening at 6 o'clock. He remembers a season of his life when he got out of the Lord's house and he wasn't in the place of blessing. And his mama spoke a word of truth into his life and said, "Son, you need to get back in the house of the Lord." And ever since that day, he's been back in the house of the Lord, serving the Lord. Stephanie also told me Mom lived a hard life growing up during the Depression. She worked hard, and the best financial advice she taught us was to squeeze a nickel till it hollers. She always made sure we knew the Lord and that we were in church. She was an avid reader. You would often see her with a book in her hand and the Bible by her bed. I have passed on to my grandchildren one of my favorite things she would say: "I love you a bushel and a peck and a hug around the neck. I'll miss her, but rejoice in the fact she's celebrating with our Lord Jesus Christ and is no longer suffering." Teresa told me how she knew her mother loved her and how hard she worked to provide a home for them and to put food on the table. She didn't drive, Kathleen didn't, early on, and Teresa's dad was a truck driver, so he was off on the road, so they would have to depend on other rides to get to church. And I think they lived kind of in between Oak Grove Baptist and Patterson Grove, and so I think they ended up going to both of those through the years. Teresa mentioned what a good cook she was and how they kept a big-sized garden, and they had fresh vegetables, and how they spent time canning, so they would have vegetables during the winter months. She also mentioned her favorite dessert that her mother made was chocolate pie. So on her birthday, she didn't want a birthday cake, she wanted a chocolate pie. Guess what she got? She got a chocolate pie. Yes, Kathleen was grateful to God for his goodness and his faithfulness to her, and it showed in her life, and she served the Lord with gladness. Just as Psalm 100 verse 2 tells us. You know, this is a great place just to stop a moment and ask ourselves, are we serving the Lord? We celebrate her life, but her life speaks truth to all of us. Are we serving the Lord? And if we are we doing it with joy like Kathleen did? Not only did she serve the Lord with gladness that put a smile on her face, but number two, she also kept a song in her heart. Verse 1 says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth." Then in verse 2b, "Come before him with joyful singing." We're talking about worship here. Shout joyfully to the Lord. Come before him with joyful singing. The essence of all true worship is coming into the presence of the Lord with a song of praise in your heart and a hymn of adoration on your lips, which according to both verse 1 and verse 2 should be done with joy. And that certainly characterizes Kathleen Haynes. She loved to sing, and she sang with great joy. Her heart was so full of praise and adoration because she was so grateful to be a child of God and to be loved by him, be known by him, accepted by him, and created by him. Stephanie told me how Kathleen loved to hear the piano and always wanted her to play "I'll Fly Away" for her. Brandy told me how much she enjoyed hearing Kathleen sing, especially on Fifth Sunday nights when she would get to sing. Teresa and Kathleen would sing together. What a blessing that was. Dana told me she got to sit beside her in choir and how she enjoyed seeing Kathleen's passion in her heart for music and the joy and the intensity that she sang with. Randy told me about a time he wanted his mom to sing with him at Kings Mountain Baptist, and she was getting a little older in life, and she said, "Well, Randy, I just can't see like I used to see." So she didn't sing with him. But he did sing, And he said, as I started singing, Mama was singing right there with me, and I could hear her as plain as day out in the congregation singing that song with me. And what a blessing that was. Randy said, it gives me great comfort knowing she is rejoicing and singing alto in God's heavenly choir as Kathleen continues in heaven what she loved to do here on earth, to sing joyfully to the Lord and to worship Him with praise and a heart full of gratitude. The Bible says, come before Him with joyful singing. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. Can I ask you, were you in God's house yesterday? Can I ask you, do you daily lift up your voice and give praise to God and give Him thanks and bless His name? We should all follow Kathleen's example. Keep a song in our heart and praise on our lips. God put it in my heart to go see her the week before she died. So I go to Kings Mountain, we go to White Oak, and I go in and I turn left, and I notice she's in the hallway in a wheelchair all by herself. And so I had a good visit with her that day. And we sang the praises of God together, and we prayed together. And it was good to be with her, to share the scripture and to sing together. And even though her mind and her memory had been affected by Alzheimer's, when I started singing, she would jump right in with me and sing those wonderful hymns. Without fail, she always blessed the Lord and gave Him thanks in my presence when I was with her. So Kathleen Haynes lived with a smile on her face. She served the Lord with gladness. She lived with a song in her heart. She shouted and sang joyfully to the Lord. And last of all, I would say, she also lived with a Savior leading her life. A Savior, the Savior, leading her life. Verse 3 says, in references, she knew that the Lord was God Himself, and she was a sheep of His pasture. I love what Scott Sism told me. He said, a few things I remember about my grandmother. She loved her family. She loved singing, reading, and quilting before Alzheimer's took over. But most of all, she loved God. She always asked if you were saved and had Jesus in your heart every time you visited. She always would say that she wanted to see you in heaven. Kathleen had confessed Jesus Christ as her personal Lord and Savior. She knew that she was a sinner and she needed a Savior. And she was born again. And her faith was not phony, but it was genuine. It was authentic. That's why Kathleen had heaven on her mind, because she had Jesus in her heart. She had faith at home parents. She had a mama and daddy that not only took her to the Lord's house, but stayed with her and worshiped her. And she saw the faith of the Lord Jesus lived out. So she was blessed with faith at home parents. She heard the gospel message. You know, the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so she knew the bad news, Romans 3:23. For all have sinned. Every one of us, we're born sinners. She knew the worst news, not just the bad news, but the worst news. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. If you don't hear anything else I say today, I pray you hear this. The way you deal with your sin will determine the way God deals with you. The way you deal with your sin will determine the way God deals with you. And thanks be to God, our sin does not have to send us to hell. The Bible says that's what sin does. The wages of sin is death. Think about it. Does God send people to hell? Really, sin sends people to hell when they reject God's gift of provision and pardon for their sin. That's the bad news and the worst news, but thanks be to God, we don't have to stop there today because there's good news. And the good news comes in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus Christ lived a perfect life, a sinless life. When He went to the cross, God poured out all his holy anger and wrath on his sinless son. My sins, past, present, future, your sins, the world's sins were poured out on Jesus. He took God's wrath so that we wouldn't have to. He died our death so we could receive his life, eternal life with the Father. That's the good news. But there's the best news. The best news, it's a free gift. It's a free gift. Whosoever will shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, the Bible says. And you can have a no-so salvation, not a hope-so. That's why we're celebrating today, because Kathleen had a no-so salvation. It's 1 John 5, 11 through 13 says, this is God's testimony. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you might know that you have eternal life. That's a no-so salvation, not a hope-so or maybe-so. So that's the gospel right there. That's the good news of the gospel. She heard it, she responded to it, and it impacted her life. It changed her life and her eternity. Kathleen joined Mount Sinai Baptist Church by letter in July of 1992. But she didn't stop there. In August of 2007, at age 82, she said, Pastor, I want to be baptized like Jesus. I want to be baptized in the river. Every August, we go down to the river for baptism. And she stepped into the waters down there to identify with her Lord. And again, picture her life, her old life, dying to her old way of life. And her sins being washed away as the current of that river took that dirty water and washed it right on down. And she came up a new creation, pictured her new life in Jesus Christ. And she continued to live with great joy because she had been changed from the inside out. Thanks be to God for the witness. And to 82 years old, she was still running her race for God's glory. And she kept running, and she hit the tape wide open. She longed to honor the Lord. She meant business with the Lord. Barbara Bridges told me the thing that stood out to her and some of the testimonies that Kathleen would share in Sunday school that she shared was her willingness and her choice to forgive her son-in-law. Her niece Wanda also wrote about that. Wanda said, the one thing I most admire about Aunt Kay, in which she taught me by example, was her ability to forgive. And we talked about this a lot. She was able to forgive the circumstances surrounding an event in her life that no mother should ever have to. You may be thinking, how in the world could Kathleen forgive her son-in-law? I think the answer to that question is summed up in her favorite hymn, which is Without Him, that she loved to sing. Stanza one, without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I'd surely fail. Stanza two adds, without him, I'd be enslaved. Kathleen understood Jesus as a bondage breaker, a life changer. How he alone can set the captives free. How John 8:36 says of Jesus speaking, says, whoever the Son sets free shall be free indeed. Kathleen was free indeed. She not only experienced the power of the gospel and salvation, but she experienced the power of the Holy Spirit living in her and through her in the process of sanctification. She understood what she had received from God through Christ, forgiveness. She was to dispense to others. As she lived. You can't do that on your own. The Christian life is impossible to live. If you're trying to live the Christian life on your own, it's not going to work for you. The only way anybody can live the Christian life is to allow the Jesus in you to live it through you. You die to self and he lives through you. The Jesus in her was able to forgive others for their faults and failures. What a legacy to celebrate. That she lived like Jesus, forgave like Jesus. There's really what a tremendous influence, a picture. If you really want to live like Jesus, do you forgive? Do you forgive? She did. The power of God lived in her and through her. Scott also told me when I would visit her at her home, she always wanted me to play the piano, and her favorite song for me to play and for her to sing along with was Without Him. That's how she could forgive. The Jesus in her moved her to extend forgiveness to others. Again, there's no better point of application right here than for us just to pause a minute. Kathleen has received her reward, but we're still here. Now, you may be in bondage. You may be in captivity. You may not think you are, but if you have an unforgiven spirit, if you have resentment, if you have bitterness in your life, you're in captivity. You're poisoning yourself. The Bible says that you need to experience the grace of God, and you need to let go like Kathleen, and you need to give to others what God gave to you. He gave you forgiveness, and you need to give it to others. Scott said, when I was with her on Monday, the day she died, she slept most of the time, and that was okay. A couple of times she opened her eyes and poked up at the ceiling and would just stare. Of course, I knew she was seeing somebody and asked her who she was seeing, and she never said anything, but she just smiled. I knew she was seeing Jesus or heaven or maybe a loved one, but I knew she was ready to go there and be with them, and she did peacefully. And on July the 29th, around 8:30 p.m., Kathleen Haynes sang another song that she loved and she knew, and we're about to hear, called Goodbye World, Goodbye. As the choir sings this song, let's bless the Lord and praise His name for the life, love, and legacy of faith of Kathleen Haynes. And following this song, Goodbye World, Goodbye, no better way to end this service in here than to say and to sing Without Him. And when the choir begins to sing Without Him, if you have been moved by the Holy Spirit of God today, and Kathleen's request that she would always want to make sure her family and friends were in heaven, if you know today, if you were to take your last breath, you would not be in heaven, and you want to believe and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, if you want to talk to me, I'll be down here to the left as the choir sings Without Him. And what a fitting way for her life to continue to point to Jesus, point others to Jesus. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful singing. Thanks be to God, Kathleen did. And so she was ready to say, goodbye, world. Goodbye. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for the wonderful life and legacy of Kathleen Haynes. I thank you, Lord, for allowing us the privilege to do life with her. And we just pray for her family, Lord, in the days, months, years ahead, that you would allow them to think and dwell on all the good and all the wonderful times and the legacy of faith that she has left us all. So we realize, Lord, every good and perfect gift comes from you. And we thank you most of all for your Son, who cleanses us when we confess our sins, who redeems us and adopts us, Lord. Hallelujah, what a Savior you are, Jesus. So thank you for this time of worship. Thank you for being with us. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll continue the service next across the road here as we lay her body to rest. Please stand.